Happy Tuesday! It's a Tuesday, everybody, and I'm apparently wearing pink and black, but I don't know, with the lighting it looks a bit different. Good morning, everybody! You are streaming live with us right here on Attenville TV! Yeah! This is the Crack of Dawn show with myself, Kimara Hiralal, as your host. And if you want to interact with us in studio today, please do so with the contact details, which you'll see at the bottom right of your screen, right there. Or you could just use the bottom column where it says live chat. As Ramashni Padachi comes in this morning, she says, good morning. Morning, honey. How you doing? All right. So it's a Tuesday, and you know how this works. I make you laugh a little bit. I tell you something serious about your current affairs, and then hopefully I make you laugh a little bit again. And then you have a total beautiful kind of day. Yeah? Now we're going to work with that. That's the whole... It's like the whole point of the show. It's to make you smile in the morning. It's to also educate you a little bit about your current affairs. And if you're wondering about a little something, we put a little documentary together. But in between, yeah, we have a few good laughs. Hence, I got a good personality, right? Look at me tooting my horn so early in the morning. All right, if you just join us and if you're watching the show for the first time, please don't forget to like, share and subscribe to this channel if you haven't done it already. And if you are a subscriber, please click on the share button as often as you can, especially if you're watching the show. A lot of people are on social media, right? So you've got your Facebook, you've got your groups, you've got your friends, you've got your family broadcast group, you've got your friendship broadcast group, whether it's WhatsApp, Twitter, whatever. Help us lift the numbers of the station as it does uplift the community. And as the numbers go up, we generate funds, we generate business, and then we help uplift those who can't uplift themselves. All right, so stay tuned for the jam-packed show as we got a nice lineup for you today. We got Wackhead Simpson, and we also got Kyle McWaters helping us learning about the Bermuda Triangle. Oh, the Bermuda Triangle. What do you know about the Bermuda Triangle? You just know about the shipwrecks and the flights that go down there. You don't really know the info as to why it works that way. A lot of people have like mythical theories about what the Bermuda Triangle is all about. But stay tuned for a jam-packed show as we're going to find out throughout the show what is happening in the Bermuda Triangle. But before we do, let's take a quick commercial break. We'll come back straight after this.
You can do anything. All you need is determination and a fresh pair of these nullies. But what's the point of looking like in your game if all your money's on your feet and your dreams go up in flames? In this world of doing it for a gram, do you want a bank that takes your money or a bank that takes your money seriously?
Welcome back, honeys. If you just joined us, you are streaming live with us right here on Attenville TV. Yeah. This is the Crack of Dawn show with myself, Kimara Hiralal, as your host. And if you want to interact with us in studio today, please do so with the contact details right there at the bottom right of your screen. Or you could use the bottom column where it says live chat. We've got Alan Murgan coming in this morning. He just says, morning. Morning then, Mr. Murgan. All right, so opening up the show this morning, as I like a good laugh in the morning, we got Wackhead Simpson. Now, Wackhead Simpson makes me laugh every day. My favorite, personal favorite, radio TV presenter. Here he is, coming up next.
As is always the case, I ask ridiculous questions. But I don't believe them to be ridiculous. I believe them to be questions that really need an answer. All right, today it is no different. Here is this morning's senseless survey.
Thank you for calling.
Good morning, ma'am. I'm agent 31962. I'm calling you from the Census Bureau. I just need literally 30 seconds of your time to ask you a few questions for your country.
Okay.
Ma'am, does it freak you out to know that we are closer to the year 2075 than to 1970?
No, it's fine. I don't mind.
Are you aware that if you don't raise your kids properly, you'll have to raise your grandkids? Ma'am, how exciting is it that there are hundreds of people out there who are wearing clothing that you tried on but never bought?
Oh, that must be a lot, eh?
Ma'am, do you not trust microwaves that don't spin the food?
I don't know. No, I wouldn't be able to answer that one.
Do you know that passwords, they're like underwear. They should never be shared and changed frequently.
Yeah, can be true.
Ma'am, do you wish that your neck fat rolls were as cute as your dog's neck fat rolls?
I don't have neck fat. I've got neck wrinkles.
Oh, girl.
Are you aware that if you replace potato chips with kale chips as a snack, you can lose up to 90% of what little joy you have in your life?
Yes.
Ma'am, how long, due to inflation, saying you look like $1 million actually becomes an insult?
No, I don't know that answer.
Can the saying, it's the thought that counts, apply to exercise?
No.
When we were kids, we hated getting spanked and taking naps. Are you now into both of those things?
Depending who's spanking.
And ma'am, do you know this? That if a man says, I don't have a condom, you should say, that's fine, I'm ready to be a parent.
Sure.
That's your senseless survey.
Wacken Simpson right here on Attenville TV. You know what? You can still catch him on 94.7 around 10-ish. But you know what? He's made my youth. From the time I was a little kid, this guy got me laughing every single weekday at 10 past 7 every morning. Well, I hope we get to do the same for you every morning right here on Attenville TV. I'm the cracker dad, cracking it up where you are. Ramashi Panachi, if you are there, still there, honey, tell us, give us a bit of feedback on your whack head if you like it. If there's anything else you'd like to share with us on the air, please do comment at the bottom where it says live chat. Now, if we're going to take you through a nice documentary or a nice informative show about the Bermuda Triangle, stay tuned for that as we'll come back straight after this commercial break.
Put a spell on you. Because you're mine. Oh, because you're mine. Because you're mine.
Welcome back, everybody, if you just joined us. You are live with us on Attenville TV. Well, this is the Crack It Down Show with myself, Kimera Hiralal, as your host. And if you want to interact with us in studio today, please do so with the contact details at the bottom right of your screen, or you can use the bottom column where it says live chat and interact with us. All right, so we decided to talk about the Bermuda Triangle this morning. All right, now, if you know anything about it that I don't, please feel free to interact with us. Drop us a message. Let us know what you think. It's quite awesome. But if you're lazy to type a message, please do drop us a WhatsApp on 074-660-5829. The phone is right next to me. I don't mind dropping your voice note. All right. Now, for those of you who don't know what the Bermuda Triangle is, now, the Bermuda Triangle is also known as the Devil's Triangle, right? Now, it's urban legends. It focuses on a loosely defined region in the western part of North Atlantic Ocean. Now, this is where a number of aircrafts and ships are said to have disappeared under mysterious circumstances. And also the idea of the area is uniquely prone to disappearances, well, which arose in the mid-20th century. Now, but those reputable resources, or sources rather, dismiss the idea that there is any mystery about the Bermuda Triangle. Now, the earliest suggestion of unusual disappearances in the Bermuda area has appeared in September. Well, to be exact, 17th of September, 1950. All right. And this there was an article published in the Miami Herald that 2 years later, the Fate magazine published, right? So Edward Van, he calls himself Edwin Van Winkle Jones. Now, 2 years later, Fate magazine published Sea Mystery at a back door, right? Now, it's a short article about George Sand covering the loss of several planes and ships, including the loss of Flight 19. Now, a group of five U.S. Navy Grumman TBM Avenger torpedo bombers on a training mission also disappeared. But Sand's article was the first to lay out the now familiar triangular area where the losses took place, as well as the first to suggest a supernatural element to the Flight 19 incident. Now, Flight 19 alone would be covered again in April 1962 issue of American Legend magazine, as well as in it, author Alan W. wrote the flight leader had been heard saying, "We are entering whitewater. Now, nothing seems right. We don't know where we are. The water is green, no white." And he also wrote that officials at the Navy Board of Inquiry stated that the planes flew off to Mars. So basically what they're saying is, you know, every time they fly, we have a couple of people who are still living, and they tell us that it's as if they traveled from one place to another, like in a time capsule, but they feel like they bent time and everything was supernatural. Now, before we get to a little bit of my homework or my research in depth about the Bermuda Triangle, let's talk about the top five terrifying stories about the Bermuda Triangle. Let's start at number five with the U.S. It's called USOs. We've got Kyle McWaters coming in just to help us this morning with a little presentation. Check him out.
Your horrifying host, Kyle McWaters. And did you know that there's a void in the Atlantic Ocean in which, when things enter, they don't exit? Some say it's gas bubbles, some say it's magnets under the water. Hunker down, dudes, because here's the top five terrifying stories about the Bermuda Triangle. Number five, USOs. In the past 500 years, at least 50 ships and 20 aircraft have vanished in the Triangle. Majority of them without a trace. Like, no trace. No bodies, no sunken ships, nothing. Many have disappeared in calm waters, too, without having even sent a distress signal back home. The Bermuda Triangle is scary because it's a general area of Atlantic Ocean between Bermuda, Florida, and Puerto Rico. So that's a pretty huge distance. This hot spot of activity regularly sees many ships and aircrafts traveling through it. In fact, it happens every day. So it's not like a total black hole thing, but it's weird. Our first recorded recount seems to take us back to Columbus on his travels. Some of the earliest tales come from him and his crew. During his first journey across the Atlantic Ocean in 1492, Columbus apparently reported seeing really strange sightings in and around the triangle. Apparently, he wrote the stars appeared to move around in the sky. Yeah, they're not supposed to do that. Could have been the waves on the ship. Who knows? Another was that Columbus saw a light candle moving up and down in the distance. When he asked his crew to look at it, it would vanish and then reappear over and over again. The strangest thing that Columbus said was that he saw a glowing object coming out of the water and shoot up towards the sky. He wrote in his logbook a haywire compass, strange lights, and a burst of flame falling into the sea all took place at the Triangle. I don't know about you, but I'm the UFO guy around here, and this screams UFO all over it. Actually, it screams USO, unidentified submerged object. Things in and out of the water, bright lights moving around. 1492, people. What was going on back then above the skies of the water?
Thanks to that, Kyle McWaters with number five. That was number five. We went backwards now. We're talking about the top five terrifying stories about the Bermuda Triangle. A very, very good morning to Kasigan Padashi. Should I say Uncle Kasigan? Good morning to you. Thank you so much for joining the show this morning. Ramashi Padashi still coming in saying, "Wackhead always makes me laugh." Yeah, that's what we gotta do in the crack of dawn. All right. So going back to the Bermuda Triangle right now, as Kyle McWaters has shared with us, that, you know, it's Miami, Puerto Rico, and Bermuda, right? So there's your triangle right there. Now, the subsequent writers did not necessarily follow this definition, though. And some writers have different boundaries and vertices to the triangle, with a total area of varying from 1.3 million to 3 million, well, over 3 million kilometers. And this is now squared, dude. So this is really, really big. This is a very big area for things to happen or mysteries going to happen. And indeed, well, some writers even stretch it as far as the Irish coast. I don't know how true that is. But yeah, okay, so consequently, the determination of which accidents occurred inside the triangle depends on the writer which reported them. Now, looking at the criticism of the concept, let's talk about that a little bit. Now, there is criticism and there are things that explain why the Bermuda Triangle is this way. Now, according to Larry Coucher, author of the Bermuda Triangle mystery, was actually solved in 1975. Now, it was argued that many claims of Gaddis and subsequent writers were exaggerated, dubious, or unverifiable. Now, Coucher's research revealed a number of inaccuracies and inconsistencies between the Berlitz accounts and statements from eyewitnesses, participants, and others involved in the initial incidents. Now, Coucher noted cases where pertinent information was unreported. So also, such as the disappearance of the round world yachtsman Donald Crowhurst. Okay, these people are all about moving their yachts, hanging out, you know, near Miami. You know how the lifestyle is. You see it in the movies, right? Now, to be honest, despite the clear evidence of the contrary, another example was the Oricuria recounted by Berlitz as lost without trace 3 days out of the Atlantic port, where it had been lost 3 days out of a port with the same name in the Pacific Ocean. Now, Coucher also argued that a large percentage of the incidents that sparked allegations of the triangle's mysterious influence actually occurred well outside. Now, often his research was simple, okay? He would review period newspapers of the dates of the reported incidents and find reports on possibly relevant events like unusual weather. I mean, especially when it comes to unusual weather that were never mentioned in the disappearance stories. Remember, there's things like cyclones, tropical cyclones. If you did a bit of geography growing up in high school, you'll actually realize there are some scientific explanations behind the Bermuda Triangle. Now, let's look at Coucher's, let's call it research and what he reported. Now, Coucher concluded that the number of ships and aircrafts reported missing in the area was not significantly greater, proportionally speaking, than in any part of the ocean. Now, in an area frequented by tropical cyclones, the number of disappearances that did occur were, for the most part, neither disproportionate, unlikely, or nor mysterious. Now, furthermore, Berlitz and other writers would often fail to mention such storms or even represent the disappearance as having happened in a calm condition where meteorological records clearly contradict this. Now, the numbers themselves had been exaggerated by sloppy research, as well as the boat's disappearance, for example, would be reported, but its eventual, if belated, return to port may not have been. Funny, right? Now, some disappearance had in fact never happened, and one plane crash was said to have taken place in 1937. Now, Daytona Beach, Florida, in front of hundreds of witnesses, a check of the local papers revealed nothing. Now, the legend of the Bermuda Triangle is a manufactured mystery, guys. Now, also, it's perpetuated by writers or either purposely or unknowingly made use of misconceptions, faulty reasoning, and sensationalism. Now, in 2013, there was a study done, right? And the World Fund, they call it the Worldwide Fund for Nature, identified the world's 10 most dangerous waters for shipping. But the Bermuda Triangle was not amongst any of these. Now, let's take a look at number four with McWaters. Let's see what he has to show us with the X-Men.
Number four, X-Men. Launched in May of 1910, the USS Cyclops was a Proteus-class of Collier built for the United States Navy by William Cramp and Sons Company. Colliers are huge cargo ships designed for transporting coal. However, the Cyclops was hauling manganese ore, a material much denser than core, which could lead to something interesting theories about her disappearance. In 1918, the cursed vessel left port in Rio de Janeiro, heading for Barbados. Unfortunately, things seem to get a little spooky, though, with the voyage never being seen again. Yeah. Named Cyclops after a race of giants from the Greek mythology, she was huge and heavy. So, what happened? Skeptics believe that due to the amount of weight it was carrying, that it must have sank or cracked. But that doesn't explain the 306 missing passengers, zero distress calls, zero wreckage found from the United States Navy. The loss of a ship and crew still remains the largest loss of life at sea the history of the United States Navy ever endured, not directly involving combat. The Caribbean Sea creates huge areas of shallow water that can be treacherous to ship navigations. And there's some evidence to suggest that the Bermuda Triangle is a place where magnetic compasses point towards true north as opposed to magnetic north. Could explain why so much metal like all that ore and coal might have pulled the ship down from the magnetism. But what's so magnetic under the sea? I think the US Navy owes some odd 306 people's families an explanation. I'm looking at you, Freedom of Information Act.
All right. Further responses about the Bermuda Triangle. Now, when the UK Channel 4 television program, the Bermuda Triangle, this happened in 1992, by the way, right? Now, the Bermuda Triangle was being produced by John Simmons. Now, John Simmons of the Geofilms of the, it's called the Equinox series. I don't know if you guys heard of it. If you haven't, take a look-see at it. And the marine insurance market Lloyd's of London was asked if an unusually number of ships had sunk in the Bermuda Triangle area. Now, Lloyd's determined that the large number of ships that did not actually sink there. So Lloyd does not charge higher rates for passing through this area. And the United States Coast Guard also records confirm that this is their conclusion. In fact, the number of supposed disappearances is relatively insignificant, considering the number of ships and aircrafts that pass through the regular basis, right? So there's many people that go through there at a regular basis, and there's probably just a bad timing, like, you know how you get a high tide in the ocean, and, you know, there's times for these high tides. So there's probably times for the Bermuda Triangle as well. Now, the Coast Guard is also officially skeptical of the triangle, right? Nothing that they collect and publish through their inquiries, much documentation contradicting many of the incidents written about the triangle authors. Now, in one such incident involving the 1972 explosion, the sinking of the tanker V.A. Fogg, the Coast Guard photographed this wreck and recovered several bodies, in contrast with the triangle's author's claim that all bodies had vanished. But with the exception of the captain, who was found sitting in his cabin at his desk clutching a cup of coffee, in addition, V.A. Fogg sank off the coast of Texas, basically. So nowhere near the commonly accepted boundaries of the Bermuda Triangle. A lot of things are S. You know what I mean? Bull. Yeah. All right, coming up next, we got number 3. Check it out, Top Gun with Kyle McWatters.
Number 3, Top Gun. Flight 19 was the group of 5 Avenger torpedo bombers that disappeared over the Bermuda Triangle on December 5th, 1945, after losing contact during a United States Navy overwater training flight from Fort Lauderdale. All 14 airmen on the flight were lost, as well as all 13 crew members of a Martin Mariner, which was a search and rescue boat that went looking for Flight 19. Neither of them to be seen again. Flight 19 was flying a routine navigation and combat training exercise. Top Guns up there training the rookies, you know? The flight leader was a United States Navy Lieutenant Charles Taylor. Navigation of the route was meant to teach dead aerospace principles to students, like using your surroundings instead of your instruments. A little calculating on the fly. Radio conversations between the pilots were overheard in the area. The radio transmissions were as followed. Quote, I don't know where we are. We must have got lost after that last turn. Both my compasses are out. I'm trying to find Fort Lauderdale, Florida. I'm over land, but it's broken. I am sure I'm in the Keys, but I don't know how far down. We are heading 30 degrees for 45 minutes, then we will fly north to make sure we are not over the Gulf of Mexico. Taylor was told to broadcast on the search and rescue frequency. Taylor replied, I cannot switch frequencies, I must keep my planes intact. And that's it. Forever. In 1991, a group of treasure hunters thought they finally solved the puzzle when they swam over watery graves of 5 World War II era planes near Fort Lauderdale. Unfortunately, it was later found that they belonged to a different group of Navy planes whose serial numbers did not match. The search continues to this day with no signs of the 6 aircraft or 27 crewmen. The United States Navy simply doesn't lose 6 planes with Navy members on board. So what exactly happened in 1945?
Right. Thanks, Kyle McWatters. Thank you so much, honey, for helping us with your research. For some reason, people need to realize that with this day and age and with our modern technology, we should be able to see what is happening at the Bermuda Triangle with all those gadgets that we have. I mean, hey, nowadays people can make babies without even reproducing. You know, look at Elon Musk. He can make people. He can clone people. All right. Okay, so moving on about the Bermuda Triangle. Now, the Nova Horizon episode, right? Let's talk about that one a little bit. Now, there's the case of the Bermuda Triangle aired on June 27, 1976. Now, this was highly critical, stating that when we've all gone back to the original sources of the people involved, the mystery actually evaporates. Okay, now science does not have to answer questions about the triangle because those questions are not valid in the first place. So ships and planes behave in the triangle the same way that they will behave everywhere else in the world. Now, skeptical researchers, let's call them that, such as Ernest Tubbs and Barry Singer, have not noted how mysteries and the paranormal are very popular and profitable. But this has led to the production of vast amounts of material on topics such as Bermuda Triangle. They were able to show that some of the paranormal activity material is often misleading or inaccurate. Now, it's also had its producers continuing to market this accordingly, and they have also claimed that the market is based in favor of books. All right. Now, TV specials and other media that support the triangle mysteries and against the well-researched material, if it is, espouses, it's also skeptical. It's a skeptical viewpoint. Let's take a look at number two with the Dwarf Panthera Tigris.
Number two, Dwarf Panthera Tigris. Star Tiger was an Avro Tudor 4 commercial passenger aircraft owned and operated by British South American Airlines and disappeared without a trace over the Atlantic Ocean while on a flight between the Azores and Bermuda. I kinda already know where this thing's going. On January 30th, 1948, Star Tiger took off from the Azores in order to complete the last leg of a flight from London to Bermuda. This, unlike the Flight 19 crew, was not a military plane or exercise. Prior to takeoff, the plane had some problems with a heater, as well as malfunctioning compasses. Probably not a good start to the whole Bermuda Triangle trip, huh? The plane continued on its original schedule behind a weather plane that served as a lookout for signs of coming threats. To keep the plane at a warmer temperature, they flew extremely low at 2,000 feet, eliminating virtually any sort of wiggle room for a problem if it should arise. Keeping the plane cool, the low altitude caused the plane to burn fuel much faster than if it had been flying high using fall as fuel. When the weather plane landed and was not immediately followed by the Star Tiger, ground control began to worry. Minutes turned into hours, and rescue crews searched and searched, but no luck. All 25 passengers and 6 crew members were never seen or heard from again. I'm kind of shook right now, to be honest. Like, I'm baffled. Investigators conclude that the whereabouts of the plane, a life jacket, or even a single piece of glass has yet to be found related to the Star Tiger.
All right. Getting kind of antsy. I'm looking at these stories and I just feel there are things called human error. Things can go wrong in a flight. Things can happen. It's natural. Okay, anyway, a very good morning to Kim Panacci coming in this morning. Good morning to you and to Kim. Thanks for joining the show this morning. And to Kim, what do you know about the Bermuda Triangle? And to Uncle Cassigan, what do you know about the Bermuda Triangle? Ramashni, what do you know about the Bermuda Triangle? Share with us live on the air. What do you know, really? What story or what basics do you know about the Bermuda Triangle? A lot of people talk about it, but not everyone has an actual fact or true story. Yeah. All right, so let's get into it now. Before I explain my side of my research and my story, we're going to talk about the hypothetical explanation attempts, especially the paranormal and the natural, let's call it paranormal and natural explanations. But before we get to that, let's kick it off with number one with Kyle McWaters and see what he has to say.
In the number one spot, Lady Sylvia. This one I chose for number one because it gives us a little tiny clue as to what might have happened out there in this geometric nightmare. In 1976, a 180 meter or 590 foot cargo ship named Sylvia Elosa embarked through the waters. She was carrying 37 passengers along with a huge shipment cargo of iron ore. Remember now, this thing is almost 2 rugby pitches long, okay? 200 meter sprint to the other side. The ore was being shipped from Brazil to Philadelphia, but unfortunately, like pretty well all the others, the route took Sylvia right into the Bermuda Triangle. Spoiler alert, to which it would never return. No one is certain at what exact time the ship vanished, but when the company that owned her asked the Coast Guard to search for it, after the extensive weeks searching by boat and plane, the rescue teams had found something. A few pieces of debris, including a lifeboat and life jacket with burn marks all over them. Okay, so maybe a fire on the ship, or some sort of radiation or electrical burn. Maybe they escaped. Apparently, when rescue arrived on the scene, they reported seeing a thick black goo, like an oil slick, around the wreckage. The New York Times said the biggest mystery of all is that a ship that size wouldn't have sank quickly. A ship equipped with that much hull and budget, the crew should have had time to message for help, but were silenced by this tragic mystery. How come we haven't figured this out yet? Satellite images, James Webb telescope, LIDAR, drain the oceans. So how come we still haven't found these ships? UFO abductions, black hole voids, Poseidon himself, who knows? Definitely seems like something strange, to say the least. Well, there you have it, folks. Five terrifying tales about the Bermuda Triangle that will leave you absolutely shipwrecked. Dude, I haven't been able to sleep since I looked into this stuff. My mind wants to play detective every day and piece all these little clues together. What do you think? Is the Bermuda Triangle some sort of anomaly we can't explain yet? Or is it gas bubbles, mechanical errors, and weather, and it's much more terrifying than we originally thought? Beats me.
Thank you, Kyle McWatters, for giving us the top five terrifying stories about the Bermuda Triangle. It's not terrifying. It's just a matter of people stop being lazy and stop doing sloppy research and actually use your gadgets and technology to find out what is happening there. All right, for those of you that just joined us, morning, everybody. You are still streaming live with us on Attenville TV. You are watching The Crack of Dawn Show with myself, Kimera Hiralal. Yeah, I'm your host. Okay, so looking at the natural explanations, right? Let's talk about that a little bit. Now, there's something called compass variations, okay? Compass problems are one of the most, well, one of the cited phrases in many triangle incidents, okay? Now, while some have, theorized that the unusual local magnetic anomalies may exist in this area. Now, such anomalies have not been found. Now, the compasses have natural magnetic variations in relation to the magnetic poles. For those of you who went to school, listen up. Okay? Now, a fact navigators have known for centuries. There's a magnetic north, we call that on the compass, right? Your magnetic north and in geographic true north are exactly the same, only for a small number of places, though. And for example, as of 2000, in the United States, only those places on a line running, from Wisconsin, okay, all the way to the Gulf of Mexico. Now, but the public may not be informed The public may not be as informed and think that there is something mysterious about a compass changing. Now, it's across an entire large area, which is known as the Triangle, right? Look at where it's situated on the Earth. There's a whole lot of explanations, scientific and geographical as well, which is also very, very natural. And this is what happens with the Earth. These things happen. Things can change. Magnetic fields change. Positive, negative. Get me? All right. So there's something called the Gulf Stream. All right, so the Gulf Stream is a major surface current primarily driven by the thermohaline circulation that originates in the Gulf of Mexico and then it flows through the Straits of the Florida into the North Atlantic. In essence, it's a river within an ocean. And like a river, it can and does carry floating objects. Now, it's a maximum surface velocity of about, say, 60 feet. Or 6.6 feet rather. Let's call it like that, right? Now, it's a small plane making a water landing or a boat and having engine trouble. It can be carried away from its reported position just by the current. There's nothing funny happening in the Bermuda Triangle. We've got Ramashini Panachi interacting with us in studio today about the Bermuda Triangle. As I asked the question, what do you know about the Bermuda Triangle? Ramashini Panachi says, I just knew that planes and ships disappeared there. Yes, they did. But the weirdest thing is that people are trained to be pilots or sailors, you know, and there's something called human error. And people make mistakes on a daily basis and actually screw up their flights and their ships. And remember, if you did not learn your work properly, you cannot say human error. It's just you weren't clued up as to what to do in a situation where your plane or your ship was being tugged at this magnetic force. And also, knowing your geography or your science, being in that position, that means you're not very good at what you do. You should know the timings, you should know your tide times, especially when being on a boat. Yeah? Magnetic fields. If you're a pilot, you should know these things. Well, if you're qualified, that's also freaks me out, is that, were these people qualified? Yeah. All right, so then there's something called human error, as we just mentioned. Now, one of the most cited explanations of official inquiries as to the loss of any aircraft or vessel is human error. All right. Now, human stubbornness may have caused businessmen. This is true. Okay, so let's say stubbornness may have caused businessman Harvey Convier to lose his sailing yacht. As he sailed into the teeth of the storm south of Florida, January 1st, 1958. Now, what did I just mention to you guys? Human error, or also lack of knowledge. So if you're not very good at what you do, I think you should actually make sure you become good at being a sailor or a pilot before taking other people's lives into your hands. Especially, I'm the same when it comes to driving. I will not take passengers in my car if I didn't know I was good at what I'm doing, or I know what I'm doing. It's better to know what you're doing. Because remember, you have other people's lives in your hands. And as far as I'm concerned, there's nothing funny going on at the Bermuda Triangle. Well, interact with us in studio today as we are talking about the Bermuda Triangle. And we are talking about sensible things. We are talking about things that are natural, things that are well explained and researched, as we've done here on Attenborough TV. But before we carry on with the show, we'll come back straight after this commercial break.
Look at slide 4.
Beg you to lose your cool, think of the quarter pounder. It will taste like sunshine on a rainy day. Oh, so make it a day, the quarter pounder way. Da 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 da.
Welcome back, everybody. If you just joined us, you are live with us on Attenborough TV. This is the Crack of Dawn show with myself, Kimera Hidalal, as your host. And if you want to interact with us in studio today, please do so with the contact details that you'll find at the bottom right of your screen. Or because we're streaming live, you can use the bottom column where it says live chat. Now, today we're talking about the Bermuda Triangle. Now, I did explain everything natural about it, scientific about it, and geographical about it, right? Now, moving on to something called violent weather. I don't know if you've heard about this. If you've done your geography, you know what I'm talking about. All right. Now, hurricanes are actually powerful storms, right, that form in the tropical waters and have historically cost thousands of lives and caused billions of dollars in damage. Now, the sinking of the San Francisco de Varela's Spanish fleet in 1502 was the first recorded instance of a destructive hurricane. All right. Now, these storms have in the past caused a number of incidents related to the triangle. Now, many Atlantic hurricanes pass through the triangle as they recurve off the eastern seaboard and before the advent of weather satellite. Ships often had little to no warning of hurricanes approach that time. Now, a powerful downdraft of cold air was suspected to be a cause in the sinking of the Pride of Baltimore on May 14, 1986. Now, the crew of the sunken vessel noted that the wind suddenly shifted and increased velocity from, 32 kilometers per hour to all of a sudden it went to 20, and then it went 95, and then it went 145, and it was just like crazy. But a Natural Hurricane Center satellite specialist, James Lushine, who would like to say hi, stated that during a very unstable weather condition, that the downburst of cold air from the aloft can hit the surface like a bomb, exploding outward like a giant squall line of wind and water at the same time. Now, a similar event occurred in Concordia in 2010 off the coast of Brazil, and the explanation for some of the disappearances has focused on the presence of large fields of methane. Now, it's called methane hydrate, so it's basically a form of natural gas that happens under the ocean. Yeah. All right. So on the continental shelves, laboratory experiments carried out in Australia have proven that bubbles can indeed sink a scale model ship by decreasing the density of the water, which is true. I've done something like that for show and tell to just prove something. Yeah. All right. So any wreckage consequently rising to the surface would be rapidly dispersed by the Gulf Stream. Now, it has been hypothesized that pyritic methane eruptions, sometimes called mud volcanoes, right, may produce regions of frothy water that are no longer capable of providing adequate buoyancy for ships. Now, just remember, if this was the case, or if this were the case, rather, such an area forming around a ship could cause it to sink very rapidly without warning. All natural. Ladies and gentlemen, if you know anything about the Bermuda Triangle, do interact with us in studio today. There's a column right there that says live chat. You can even drop us a WhatsApp or voice note if it's easier for you and you're lazy this morning. 074-660-5829. Well, that's it for the Bermuda Triangle, as we are going to keep you a little entertained this morning. Oh, yes, you know it. We're all about showcasing talent. But before we do, don't go anywhere. We're going to come back straight after this. Welcome back, everybody. If you are live with us for the first time, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to this channel. Well, you are streaming on Attenville TV. Yeah, yeah. This is the Crackerdown Show with myself, Kimera Hidalal, as your host. And if you want to interact with us in studio today, please do so with contact details at the bottom right of your screen, or you could use the bottom column where it says live chat. As we see people coming in on our chat, this is a show not for hot photos and girls here. This is an intelligent show about your current affairs, and we make you laugh here on the Crack It On. Ain't got nothing to do with hot photos, honey. All right. Now, for those of you who just joined us for the very first time, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to this channel if you haven't done it already. And we would like to up our subscribers. We're trying to hit 1,000 now. We just went over a little 200, but if you can help us share the link, it'll be much appreciated. Okay, so we just finished off with a show called The Bermuda Triangle. Quite interesting. Nothing mythical about it. Nothing unnatural about it. It's all about science and geography, honeys. You just got to understand your job before you do it. All right. So today we're all about showcasing talent. Remember that if you've got talent and you've got a smartphone, capture it with your smartphone. Drop us a WhatsApp on 074-660-5829 and let us know that you have talent and you'd like to submit your content for us to showcase right here on Attenville TV. Coming up today, you guys know Lady Gaga, right? When last did I listen to a Lady Gaga song? All right, anyway, there's a song called Always Remember Us This Way by Lady Gaga, but today it is covered by House of Gaga Studios. Check them out.
That Arizona sky burning in your eyes. You look at me, babe, on the kitchen fire. It's buried in my soul like California cold. You found a light in me that I couldn't. when lovers in denial, poets trying to write. We don't know how to rhyme, but damn, we try.
Doing a cover version of Lady Gaga's Always Remember Us This Way. Brilliant delivery. Oh my god, I love the band, I love the girl, I love everything about them. Now that is talent, that is brilliance. Thank you so much for that. All right, so as we're showcasing talent, let's kick it off to Durban a little bit. Yeah, all right, so now we've got Siyanda Mhlaba and a lady named Fazlin Naidoo. All right, they've done an original song which was composed by Deshan Styler Naidoo himself. All right, now, he composed the music, but Siyanda and Fazlin have actually written the words to the song. Now, you know what you're going to like about this? It's a great mix with the Tamil language as well as English. So it's got like a nice fusion there. Now, they're all the way in Durban with a song called Dear No One. Check it out.
But जाती है
Maslava and Fazlin Naidoo all the way in Durban with an original track called Dear No One. This was composed by Dejan Stylin Naidoo himself, and the lyricists were Siyana Maslava and Fazlin Naidoo themselves. A very beautiful song, beautiful delivery. We've got Kim Padachi coming in on YouTube. Great show. Keep up the good work. Thank you so much, Auntie Kim. You know what? It's an honor and a pleasure to have people like you who support the show, and it makes it worthwhile waking up every morning just to entertain you guys every single weekday. Well, don't go anywhere. It's not the end of the show. When you come back, we're gonna see, have a good laugh with Auntie Sheila, as she's got a nice joke for us today, dealing with humbling yourself. But don't go anywhere. We're gonna come back straight after this commercial break. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. If you just joined us, you are live with us on Attenville TV. This is the Crack It Down Show with myself, Kimela Hinalal, as your host. And if you want to interact with us in studio today, please do so with the contact details at the bottom right of your screen. Or you could use the bottom column where it says live chat, as we are streaming live. And today we are going to end off the show with a little good laugh. If you haven't got to work already, before you start your day, I hope we've made your day with an intelligent show with a little bit of humor. So coming up next, without further ado, coming up next, Auntie Sheila, humble yourself.
Hi, darlings. It's Auntie Sheila. Ooh, I can't wait to tell one story, right? I must give that card before Tata come away from work, you know, uncle. So anyway, my friend Vanida, that one got too much pride, airs and graces about herself, right? So anyway, we had a friend called Sweetie, and she'd always, Vanida will always pick on Sweetie. Because you know why Sweetie wasn't so successful. And she'll always say, oh, Sweetie, wearing the same clothes to the event. Always pick Sweetie, can't afford to do this. She can't afford to drive cars, etc. And you know, I always say this, darling. Be mindful of how you treat people. Because you know, Vanida, you know, I always say this. Vanida's ass was humbled the right way during COVID. You know, I don't mean to be bad. But you know, when COVID hit, how her husband's business suffered. And she had to humble herself. But still, oh God, still got that dirty munji parek. Oh God, a real suit mari way. Must never be like that. You know, Sweetie, darling, how her life changed, right? We saw, oh, yo, she was in this lucky cab and, oh, driving, holding a fancy handbag, darling. I'm like, go, Sweetie. And you must see how Vanida's face was turning. Are you? Like one sour puss, I tell you, worse than one, like someone took lemon and put in her mouth. Ayo, that's how like munji pare that face. But my point is, darling, never ever underestimate a person and don't judge people by the things that they have. We must always remember one thing, never underestimate the power of the wheel of time, because in an instant, God can change things like this. And more specifically, COVID, if there's one thing COVID taught us is never take anything for granted. You might be living in a castle one day. That same castle can crumble and you'll have nowhere to stay. So don't just because you're in a position of power or you can live an opulent life think that you have the authority to belittle anyone or treat anyone badly, because ultimately God has the power to change everything in a second. Darling, never, ever, ever take anything for granted. I say this repeatedly, we come on this earth, humble yourself, be good individuals, treat people fairly, and treat every soul respectfully. Don't treat someone differently because they have more money than the other person. Because one day, the poor person can be the rich person, and the rich person can become the poor person. God changes things in a second. Humble yourself and be mindful of how you treat individuals. See, Vanida, she had to shut her mouth in the corner and eat her words, eat humble pie, yeah. Don't be that mutra gundi. Treat everyone with love.
Auntie Sheila, everybody, right here at Attenville TV. You gotta love it. Okay, now for those of you who just joined the show, that was a new one for the Crack It Down Show. You just got to see Auntie Sheila explaining to yourself in a beautiful manner with humor, but it's also got an intelligent story to it and a good life lesson. She asked you to humble yourself. Well, that's all the time we have for today, folks. It is a beautiful Tuesday morning. Happy Tuesday, everybody, from myself, Kimela Hinalal. Bye-bye for now.